Hello friends, welcome to this video. In this video, I am going to walk you through the different services that AWS has in the security space. Security is key when we are planning to move our data and applications onto the public clouds. Hope this video will help you to understand these security services from AWS and safeguard your data and applications on AWS cloud. I have grouped these services under different categories, such as identity and access management, network security, instance security, data security, application security, encryption management, governance, log management, and monitoring. Let's begin with identity and access management space. Identity and access management is all about user management on AWS. User creation, deletion, providing the right access to an individual user is handled using an identity and access management. Let's drill down and see what all the different services that we have under identity and access management. So as you can see in the identity and access management, at a high level we have user management, and as precisely I said, user management is all about creating a local user on the AWS. The name of the service that you have for the user management in AWS is called as an AWS IAM. Okay, the way I have categorized these different services or put across these different services are, so this is the space within that particular area. I have categorized them into the subgroups, and each subgroup will have the respective names of the services that AWS offers. Okay, so as I said, user management is a particular space. In this, the name of the service that AWS has is called as an AWS IAM, Identity and Access Management. AWS IAM provides you to helps you to provide an RBAC, role-based access control. It helps you to define the policies and the permissions and the roles. So IAM not only help you to create a user to work on AWS, you can also create roles that will help you to assign to a particular service. And when a service from in AWS is communicating to another service, it can use these roles without even needing the credentials that has been created by an IAM. Okay, in terms of policies and the permissions, identity based, there are six permissions, the different types of the policies and the permissions that you can define. The policies are basically are nothing but what you want to do to this particular user. For example, to a particular user, you would like to give an access to use a service called as an S3, which is a storage service from AWS. So you may probably allow a user to use a S3 storage, or you may deny, or probably you can also specify that I want to use certain buckets under S3 to be given rights to a user to go and do read and write, or certain buckets you would like to give only read, or in certain buckets you probably do not want to give any access at all. All such things are handled using the policies and the permissions. There are six types of policies and the permissions. One is called as an identity based policies, wherein you create a policy and apply directly to a user. Resource based policies, you also can create a policy and apply at a resource level. Instead of creating at a user level, you can go and create at a resource level as well. Then permission boundaries, you can define what is the maximum of permission that a user can have. Organization SCPs. Organization SCPs are very unique in AWS. So when you have multiple accounts to manage, you can make one account as a master account, and that account can decide which user has what kind of permissions on a different accounts. That's including root as well. Okay, so that is called as an organization SCPs. Then you can also define an access control list, and then a session policies. So these are the different six kinds of policies that you can define as part of your IAM. Then you have an Active Directory. So Active Directory is one of the popular user base that we have on the on-premise today. The same Active Directory also has an important on the cloud now. AWS has four different services in terms of an Active Directory. The first service that you can have is AWS Managed Microsoft Active Directory, wherein AWS is going to host Microsoft Active Directory on the public cloud, and it's going to manage it for you. You just use it as an end user and create all your users, OUs, and everything. This is same like what you had today, managed by you on your on-premise. Now it's available as a service from AWS. If you want to connect your existing Active Directory and integrate with the IAM, then you can use an IAD connector. Instead of going with a full-fledged Microsoft Active Directory, you can also go with a simple AD with the limited functionalities of the Active Directory, or you can also choose an Amazon Cloud Directory, which is AWS own Cloud Directory service. Then in terms of identity and access management, you also have a single sign-on service. Single sign-on service will help you to define the same credentials and the same username and the passwords, okay, for different services. And the name of the service that you have is called as an AWS SSO. So one of the beauty of this SSO is that it is not restricted only to the AWS services. You can also integrate the third party services to this AWS SSO, such as, you know, you can integrate with Jenkins, you can integrate with your other HR management systems, and there are a lot of certified applications available as part of your SSO, wherein it has a built-in integration available for this particular service. So the same service, the same credentials can be used among these different applications. Okay, so that's a single sign-on service. Then you have a token service, which is called as an AWS SDS. So token service is predominantly used when you want to give a temporary access to a certain user. Then the token services can be used. So you can specify that this user should be able to download a particular document from an S3 storage, and you would like to provide a temporary token to him or temporary credentials to him to go and download that particular document from that S3, then you can use the SDS service. For your mobile and web applications, there is a service called as AWS Cognito. Cognito will help you to define your users, especially for your web and mobile based users. There is a password management also. So as you have more number of credentials, more number of users, and more number of applications to access, it is very difficult for you to go and manage the different credentials, manage the life cycle of that particular password. Every 15 days you need to recycle your password, every now and then you need to recreate your password. All such complexities is reduced by your password management group, and the name of the service that you have is called as an AWS Secret Manager. AWS Secret Manager holds the password. It also help you to recycle the password or generate a new password based on the policy that you define. For example, when there is an application that wants to connect to a database using its credential, that particular credential can be maintained within the Secret Manager, and as per your policy, let's say every 15 days you are recycling your password, then your application need not to maintain the new password. Your application can approach the Secret Manager. Secret Manager can reveal what the latest credential, latest password that it has maintained, and give it to you. And through that, application can go and communicate with the database. So that's what Secret Manager does. In terms of users, it's also important to understand what kind of activity that each user does. Like in the case of IAM, we specified certain policies to them. Let's say there is a user who has an access to go and create some virtual machines, go and create some storage buckets and all. So you really would like to understand what kind of activity the user has done. So those activities are called as an user activity logs. So there is a service called as AWS CloudTrail. AWS CloudTrail will help you to understand these activities. So it maintains all the activities done by all the users on that particular account. Be it, they might have used the CLI, they might have used an API, or they must have used AWS console to do any of the activity. All the activities are logged under AWS CloudTrail, and it maintains the data for 90 days so that you can go and see what has happened even in the last 3 months as well. Okay, there is also possibility wherein you can go and store the data in a S3 bucket for your long-term retention of this particular log file. And when we talk about production environment, I have hardly seen any cases where the entire organization are going ahead with the same AWS account. They definitely go with multiple AWS accounts. So as the number of AWS accounts increases, there are a lot of complexities that add on to manage the different credentials and different accounts, right? So there is something called as a multi AWS account management, and you can do that one with the two different aspects. One is called as an organization SCP. This is what I explained here, organization SCP. Organization SCP is nothing but you create one as a master account, and using that master account, you should be able to control which user has what kind of an access on each of the account of AWS. Okay, for that you have to create an organization, and then you have to link all your existing accounts to one of the account. There is also something called as a cross account IAM policy. Maybe you know you have different accounts managed for different purposes. Say one account you would like to maintain only for log files, another account you would like to maintain only for your virtual machines, another account you would like to maintain only for your storage. In such cases, you also have an option of going with cross account IAM policy. With this, you can give a permission which user has what kind of an access to the services from another account. Okay, so these are the different services that you have as part of your identity and access management. Let's go to network security, and we'll see how many services that AWS has in the network space. When we talk about a network security, we talk about two things: the core networking concept and then the firewall management. When we talk about core networking concept, it's all about designing your networking layer. For example, you want to design your DMZs, the internal domain, the set of IP addresses as per your organization standards, or your own DHCP, your set of range of IP address, and all that is called as your core networking concept. So these core networking concepts can be configured using a service called as AWS VPC. AWS VPC will help you to do all these networking configurations onto AWS. AWS VPC will help you to do the private and public zones. You can define certain EC2s or certain virtual machines. I do not want it in a public zone. I do not want them to be accessed over the internet. Then you can define them as in a private zone. You can also define public zones wherein you want to keep your web servers and such things which are public facing can be put on this. So these things can be created using a VPC. VPC provides two levels of security. One is called as a security group, and one is called as an access control list. Security group will help you to define the rules for all your incoming packets for your virtual machines. It's a security group. So security groups are applied at a individual EC2 level. Okay, every EC2 must have a security group allowed. For example, I want to have a EC2 with the SSH open, then that particular port 22 should be opened on the security group. Then we also have an access control list. Access control list is same like a security group, but it works at a subnet level. Okay, and access control list, you can correlate this one with your access control list that the network engineers will define on their routers on the on-premise today. It works in the same fashion. Okay, those security group and access control has larger differences in terms of how they work, but I don't want to get into those details. But security groups and access control list are a very basic level of the access control that you can do using VPC. Then you also have something called as an endpoints. VPC helps you to define the endpoints. Endpoints will ensure that the different services within AWS are communicating using its internal network rather than going out. The best example is you have an S3 storage, and then you have a virtual machine, okay, EC2. And this EC2, if it wants to communicate, it wants to save some data onto the S3, then S3 is not part of your VPC. So the request all the way go out on the internet and reaches to the S3. Instead of that, you can define the service endpoints for the S3 and tell that I want to communicate from this EC2 to this VPC using these endpoints. So AWS ensure that this communication now between S3 and EC2 is communicated using an AWS internal network and it does not go out of the AWS. Then you have a beautiful feature called the flow locks. When you enable the flow locks on the VPC, it can also be enabled on individual Ethernet card level on individual EC2. And these flow locks will help you to define the every packet. It analyzes every packet and tell you whether each of the packet has been or each of the protocol has been allowed or denied. For example, you probably have only the SSH port opened on a particular EC2, and when you enable the flow logs and when you look at the log files of it, and if there are third party people who are trying to access this particular EC2 using a port number 80, it will show you that it was tried to be accessed over the port number 80 by certain IP addresses and it was rejected. So there also be case wherein you want to restrict this SSH from a particular set of IP addresses, maybe your office IP address or maybe your home IP address, and then you block it and you write your access control list and security groups accordingly. And flow locks, when somebody is trying to access that particular EC2 using port number 22 from a different IP set, then it will show you that it was rejected. So all those things are possible using a flow logs. It collects all that data in the VPC. Then in terms of firewall management, so network the AWS provides two firewalls. One is called as a WAF. WAF is a firewall that will help you to do all the threat protection and all the standard threat protection that that any web server is usually will get vulnerable on. AWS WAF is a web application level firewall. It works at layer 7 of the OSI model. It allows you to configure rules on what you really want to control using a WAF. It works by default with OWASP top 10 security risks. It has already built-in rules to control all those risks defined as part of OWASP standards. Some of the things that it controls out of the box is the source IP that you can do. You can specify that I do not want to receive any web traffic from this set of sources. You can do a SQL injection or cross-site scripts. So all this can be controlled using WAF. The next service that you have is AWS Shield in terms of firewall management. AWS Shield is especially for the DDoS attacks that would happen on your web services. So AWS Shield comes up with two variants. One is called as a standard, one is called as an advanced. So standard will help you to do some basic configuration on the DDoS, whereas in the case of advanced, you also get access from AWS DDoS security team 24/7. So that is an advanced version of the AWS Shield that you have. Let's move on. And let's move on to instance security. When I say instance here, it is an EC2 instance that we have it on AWS. In the case of instance security, every instance that you create using the default AMIs on AWS uses the public keys and the private keys. Public keys are by default stored onto AWS database, and you'll be allowed to download the private keys. So these private keys work differently for Windows and Linux systems. In the case of Linux system, these private keys are mandatory. When you download the private keys, they are in the PEM format. So these private keys are mandatory every time you connect to an EC2 created using the default AMI. In the case of Windows, these private keys are used to retrieve the password of the Windows keys created using the Windows AMIs on the AWS. Then each EC2 instance have a flexibility in defining the public and the private IP addresses. So these range of the private IP addresses are part of the configuration that you do on the VPC that we discuss under network security. So you can define your own range, what range you want for the set of IP addresses. You can define using this VPC, and every EC2 that you launch within that VPC will get the IP address from the same range. You also have a flexibility wherein you can define whether my EC2 should have a public IP address or no. If you really do not want your EC2 to not to get access from a public domain, then you can straight away not to give a public IP address. You may choose not to give a public IP address to your EC2. Okay, so these configuration that you can do using a VPC networking configuration that we discuss in the network security. Then in terms of instance security, you also have something called as a vulnerability management, which is done by a service called as an AWS inspector. AWS inspector is an agent based solution, and when you install this AWS inspector on an EC2 of AWS, it does check for the vulnerability as defined by the industry standard, these four industry standards. It can identify the common vulnerability and exposes 1.1. It can check the vulnerability as defined in the CIS operating system security configuration benchmarks 1.0. It can also check the vulnerabilities such as network reachability 1.1, security best practices 1.0. So these are the four different kinds of vulnerability that an AWS inspector checks from an EC2 where it is installed. As part of common vulnerabilities and exposures, AWS inspector can recommend you can identify whether there is a software that has been installed which is not upgraded properly, or if there is a software which is already been known for its vulnerable ports if it is not patched. So in case of network reachability, your AWS inspector can identify and inform the port number 22 for a particular EC2 is exposed over the internet. There are no firewall rules that is blocking the access of port number 22 from internet. Okay, all such things can be identified using AWS Inspector. Then there is a beautiful tool called as a Systems Manager that has been introduced by AWS. Systems Manager does a lot of things onto the EC2. Okay, in terms of the functionality, as you can see that it does a compliance management, wherein you can go and define, you know, this is the patching level that you want to maintain for all your EC2s. It does the compliance management. It does an inventory management. It can straight away tell you what kind of EC2s that you have. It can tell you the managed instances. It will also help you to do, when I say managed instances, using System Manager, you can manage your EC2s as well as your on-premise servers. So Systems Manager will help you to do that. Then you have a Session Manager. So Session Manager is basically help you to take a remote control of an EC2 which is in a private subnet, for which there is no public IP, for which there is no Bastion server connected, for which there is no routes for you to go and connect it over the internet. Even for such systems, you can connect using a Session Manager from your browser itself. Then you have a run command. Run command is a functionality wherein you can execute certain commands on remote EC2s. Say, let's say, you know, I want to install a particular package on, you know, 10 EC2s, and you don't need to log into each of these EC2s. You can send those commands using a run command option within the Systems Manager. Then you can maintain a state manager as well. In terms of state manager, you can maintain. So using the state manager, you can define what kind of state for an EC2 that you would like to manage. For example, you want all your EC2 to be connected only with the encrypted EBS volumes. So all such states can be maintained using state manager. Then you have a patch manager. Patch manager helps you to define and do the patching on the EC2s. Then you have a distributor. So you want to distribute your agent, such as a Systems Manager agent and all. You can push those agents onto the remote EC2s. using the distributor functionality. So to do all these things, system manager is an agent based solution. There is an agent called as an SSM that you need to install it on your EC2 so that you can do all these functionalities using system manager. Very important to note is system manager is not just restricted to do these activities on the EC2. It also has several other activities which can also be done on the other services. Then you will talk about data security. In terms of data security, the first thing that you have is an access control list. You can define who should have what level of access to the data that you would like to put it onto the AWS. For example, I probably have certain data which you want to keep it private. No one in this world has an access to that particular data. Okay, only the user, only the creator of that particular data will have an access. Okay, so you can have that. By default, any data that you upload or that you store on AWS are private in nature. Other than the owner, no other user will have an access on that particular data. However, in certain cases, you probably would like to share the data with a set of users or to the public as well. For example, it could be a web application or an HTML file or a web page that you really would like to share with the rest of the world over the internet. So you can define that particular server, that particular folder will have a public access. So such things can be controlled using an access control list. Then you have a bucket policy. In terms of bucket policy, you can also define. So bucket is very specific to an S3 terminology. It is the root folder that you create in the S3, and in this particular bucket will help you to define your policies. So in the bucket policy, you can also go ahead and define who has, which user has what kind of access on that particular bucket. Okay, so that is what you can define in the bucket policies. So as you may be remembering that here in the identity and access management, I was mentioning about resource based policies, right? So that particular resource based policies are nothing but, one of the example of that particular resource based policies are nothing but these bucket policies. In terms of data security, encryption is the key. Every data that you want to keep it at rest on the AWS, you would like to encrypt. So there are three ways you can encrypt the data onto AWS. The one is called as a server side encryption, which is generally called as S3 SSE, which is called as a server side encryption. And when you say server side encryption, AWS will take care of creating the keys and encrypting the data. And whenever you retrieve the data, it uses the same key and retrieves the data for you. And then you also have a client-side encryption. Client-side encryption is basically in your on-premise, you encrypt the data and then you send it to AWS. And then AWS, you just use it as a restore. Okay, the entire key management or encryption and the decryption of the data happens in the client's premise itself. Then you have an advanced option. In the advanced option, either you can go with a KMS service or you can go with a CMK. So there is a dedicated service called as KMS, which we'll discuss when we are discussing about the encryption management. So it's called as a key management service. So using this key management service, you can create the keys, and those keys can be used to encrypt your data within the S3 storage as well as your EBS volumes. There is also an option of you creating a keys on the AWS. You can also choose to use your own keys that you created probably or on-premise. You would like to use those keys and give it to S3 to do the encryption using that particular key. And that service is called as a CMK. It's a client managed keys. Okay, CMK stands for, it's a client managed keys, wherein client will supply the keys to S3 to do the encryption. Okay. So that's about the encryption. And then you have a multiple data copies. AWS ensures that the data that you have uploaded maintains the multiple copies of it. It depends on what tier or what kind of S3 storage that you have opted for. You know, there are standard, there are single zone, there are infrequent access. So depending on what category of the S3 storage that you have opted for, accordingly AWS ensures that it maintains the multiple data copies, and accordingly it maintains the availability and the durability of the data as well. There is a very interesting thing that is called as a sensitive data analysis. Now what happens, let's assume that one of your credential in the AWS, the user credential that is used for your programmatic access of the AWS services is called as, you know, an access key and the secret key. So let's take an example that this particular access key and the secret key has been uploaded onto the S3 by mistake by one of the developer, and that particular bucket also has a public access. It means the secret key and the access key and the secret key that has a lot of privileges on your AWS has been exposed onto the internet. So how do you identify such data? For that, there is a service called as an AWS MACI. AWS MACI will help you to identify those data. Like you may have a credit card information, or you may have the data such as, you know, an access key and the secret key. AWS MACI will go and automatically search for such data. It will fetch you and it will give the information about the file and the folder where this such data are lying. And you know, you can go and either disable or, you know, remove the public access, or probably, you know, delete that particular file from your S3. Then you have a safety of your data archival. So data archival is nothing but a Glacier service that AWS has, which will help you to maintain your data for a very long term from a compliance perspective. And you want to ensure certain strategy, saying that, you know, these log files or these archivals should not be deleted by anyone in this organization for next 5 years, 10 or so, 10 years or something like that. So you can implement those things using an AWS Glacier Old Log. So Old Log will help you to define such policies, and including the root user will not be able to delete those archivals kept for a compliance perspective. Then we have an application security. In case of application security, I have categorized into three buckets. One is called as a single sign-on. So as I discussed that, you know, there is a service called as an SSO, and this SSO, AWS SSO, will help you to define the same credentials that you can use for different applications. Okay, there are n number of applications which are already compatible to work with these AWS SSOs, and if you go to the AWS SSO, it will list out all those, you know, 100 odd applications which are already certified and ready to use for the same credentials. Then SSL and TLS certificates, when you want to host your applications and which can access over the SSL and the TLS links, then you have something called as a certificate manager. You don't need to go and procure the certificates from a different service provider, certificate service provider. AWS itself can generate a certificate for you, and that particular certificate you can use it on your web applications or any other applications. Those are those you want to safeguard using SSL and TLS. For mobile and web applications, I already explained that, you know, this is an AWS Cognito that you have. In the AWS Cognito, you can very well define what kind of authentication that you would like to use it from your users. AWS Cognito also helps you to work with the different service providers, such as, you know, a Facebook, Google, or it can also have the users from its AWS, as well as it also help you to integrate with your Active Directory using XAML. Let's move on to encryption management. In terms of encryption management, you have a Cloud HSM, a service from AWS, which is a dedicated HSM from AWS for you. For example, you would like to maintain your hardware. So Cloud HSM stands for Cloud Hardware Security Module, which will help you to store your encryption keys onto public cloud. And one of the beauty of this Cloud HSM is that every Cloud HSM service that you get from AWS is a dedicated hardware for you. So this Cloud HSM, as a hardware of HSM, is dedicated for a particular organization. In no circumstances AWS shares this hardware with any other customers of AWS. And because it is a very dedicated hardware-based solution, so obviously there is a premium charge that has been associated with this. So if you do not want to go for this, then there is a software-based encryption, keys encryption management that you have from AWS, and the service is called as an AWS KMS. It's called as key management system. So internally, this key management system uses HSM itself, a shared HSM itself, where the keys of for your organizations are being managed. But one of the beauty of this KMS is KMS will never reveal the public keys. Those have been used for the encryption. It just provides you the private keys. Okay, and so with that, encryption management has for encryption management from AWS, you have a cloud HSM, which is a dedicated service, which is a dedicated hardware-based service, and then a software-based service called as KMS is available. Let's move on, and we'll see some of the services that are associated with the governance. In terms of governance, the first kind of service that we have is the compliance management. You really want to see whether the services that you have defined, the way it has been configured, is it according to the standards of security standard that has been defined by the third party standard organizations, such as it could be HIPAA or PCI data or something like that. Then there is a service called as AWS Artifacts. AWS Artifacts will help you to download all the best practices that you want, that you should follow on AWS services to meet the compliance defined by these third party standards. Then in terms of change management, so it's very important for you to understand in the AWS who has done changes on what services and in what time, and how it has been affected by the different services. For example, there could be a scenario where you have a security group that has been configured for a particular EC2, and one of the user went ahead and changed or blocked some of the ports on that security group, removed some of the ports from that particular security group list, and suddenly the service stops working. How will you go and understand, who has done what, and how was it impacted on your services? All such things are part of your change management. AWS services has two services. One is called as an AWS Config service. AWS Config is a very dedicated service that will show you each that will show you the different services, the change in the different services. It also tells you at what particular time and the date the change was made. It also tell you whatever the changes that has been undergone by a resource is, how it is related to the other services as well. Like I took an example of a security group. If there is a change in the security group, it will also show you, it of course shows you what are the changes that has been done on the security group. It also tells you to how many resources does this security group is connected to. Okay, and then you have AWS CloudWatch events. AWS CloudWatch events will help you to identify that particular change in the environment, as well as help you also to do some execute remediation action on that. For example, there could be an instance that could be shutting down, and as soon as you sense that it is shutting down, you probably would like to do some actions on that. Maybe intimate a certain set of people in the group who are in charge of managing those EC2s, or probably you would like to run a Lambda function to do something, some other activities like starting another EC2 or something like that. So all those things can be done using AWS CloudWatch events. Then there are best practices in terms of governance. So these best practices are nothing but it will tell you whether you are in line with the best practices that has been defined by AWS. So AWS has five best practices, and they are called as AWS best practices pillars. So the best practices that AWS defines into five categories. One is called as the cost of performance. Then you have security, then you have fault tolerance, then you have service limits. So the best practices, the AWS Trusted Advisor will go and analyze the entire services that you're using on the AWS, and will give the results telling that whether you are able to meet these best practices of AWS or no. For example, let's say you probably have an Elastic IP that has been created in the AWS account, but it is never connected to an EC2. So it goes and advises that. Or there could be an EC2 which probably is a very high configuration EC2, and probably it is underutilized. The utilization is always probably not 2-3%, and whereas you know the very high configuration of the EC2 that you might have taken. So all such for all such things will be identified by the trusted advisor as part of the best practices analysis of AWS. Then of course you have a AWS system manager which will help you to do the compliance management, the patch management, the state management, and everything for a set of EC2s. Let's move on and understand the log management capabilities that AWS has. In terms of log management, the first thing is the log generation. There are all the services that you have in AWS generates logs whenever the services are in use, especially some of the logs that you explicitly can enable for the advanced logging. So some of such logs that you can generate are CloudWatch logs. So CloudWatch logs is very important. Like when you run an EC2, EC2 itself generate lot of logs internally. Maybe you know the service logs, or maybe in the case of Windows, you have Windows events. All such logs, if you want to collect these different logs generated within the EC2 and have it in a common place to analyze, you can use the CloudWatch logs. So CloudWatch logs is again an agent based service. You need to install this CloudWatch logs agent onto an EC2, and then you define whatever the logs that you want to collect from that particular EC2. So it will collect and it will go and store it on the CloudWatch event, on the CloudWatch. Okay, then you have flow logs. Of course, we discussed about flow logs in the case of VPC, wherein flow logs will help you to you have to enable explicitly to go and collect all the packets that are flowing in and out of your network. Then you have a cloud trail. You have to go and enable the cloud trail that will help you to define that will help you to identify the activities those have been carried out on the set of services. CloudTrail also works on a multi-account as well as multi-region based. So any user who has, you can define in an organization unit that I want to also understand the different activities done on a different account, then CloudTrail will help you to do that. Then you have a DNS logs. So when I say DNS logs is specific to Route 53 service of AWS, wherein any DNS request that has been made, or the number of success and the number of failures for that particular DNS, such logs can also be generated over the Route 53 service. Then you have log analytics. It is not just important to generate the logs, it's also important for you to go and analyze those logs as well. In terms of analytics of the logs, you have two important services from AWS. One is called as a AWS Guard Duty. Guard Duty basically analyzes three kinds of logs: flow logs, it does CloudTrail, and then it does DNS logs. It collects these three and does the analysis. It can tell you some of the it can help you to identify some of the attacks that could be happening on your infrastructure. Some of them could be a DNS data exfiltration, it could be around SSH brute force attack, or it could be a penetration test that somebody may be doing on your infrastructure. So all such activities, those may be happening on your infrastructure, will be identified by the guard duty. Then you have an AWS Athena. AWS Athena will help you to write the simple SQL queries on the logs, and then help you to understand or help you to query the data according to your requirement or your need. Athena is will predominantly work on the logs those have been stored on the S3, and you just need to write the similar SQL commands, like I would like to know the URI and the timestamp of this particular activity and run on that particular S3 storage, and it fetches you all that information is an Athena. In terms of log consolidation, so you have a security hub. AWS Security Hub can collect the data from cross account. It not only restricted to the services from AWS, it can also collect the logs from different third party applications which are certified by AWS. As of now, Security Hub can collect the data from different accounts, from different services such as AWS WAF, GuardDuty, Inspector, Macie, and IAM Access Analyzer. So you can collect all these different logs into a common place, and you can view them and you can analyze them in a common place. And that's what the Security Hub provides you the facility with. The next one is the centralized logging. Centralized logging help you to collect the logs into a common account of AWS. As we were discussing that in the earlier in the identity and access management, where you can have a organization and from a master account you will be able to control the different level of access that you'd like to give for the different accounts. The same way when you have multiple accounts and each account is maintained for different purposes. For example, certain accounts meant only for virtual machine, there are certain accounts you would like to maintain only for storage, and if you want to maintain a particular account only for collection of the logs, then you'll be able to enable these different logs in a different accounts to send the logs into a common account. Okay, that is what you can do with the centralized logging. However, the configuration of these collection or the sending the data to a different account varies from services to service, but however, it is well possible with all the services of AWS to send the logs, send all its logs to a common account for a centralized logging. So let's move on and let's go to the monitoring session of it. In terms of monitoring, of course, you have a CloudWatch, AWS CloudWatch, and this particular CloudWatch will help you to go and see all the alerts and all the logs those have been generated in the AWS's. And then of course you have a CloudTrail. CloudTrail will also help you to list all the logs in terms of the activity that has happened on the AWS account. So these are the different services that we spoke about. I had tried to collect all the different services provided by the AWS as of now. If you feel that I have missed any of the services, please let me know and I'll be more than happy to include that particular service into one of this category of the services. Okay, so thank you guys, and hope this video will definitely help you in understanding these different services and safeguard your data and applications on the AWS cloud. Okay, please do provide your comments and suggestions about this particular video on the below section. Okay, thank you once again, guys.